the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Dear brothers and sisters, on this most sacred night in which our Lord Jesus Christ passed over from death to life, the Church calls upon her sons and daughters, scattered throughout the world, to come together to watch and pray. If we keep the memorial of the Lord's Paschal solemnity in this way, listening to his word and celebrating his mysteries, then we shall have the sure hope of sharing his triumph over death and living with him in God. We now bless this Paschal candle. Christ, yesterday and today, the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, all time belongs to him, and all the ages, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. By his holy and glorious wounds, may Christ the Lord guard us and protect us. May the light of Christ rising in glory dispel the darkness of our hearts and minds. Yes.
Christian believers apart from worldly vices and from the gloom of sin, teaching them to grace and joining them to his holy ones. This is the night.
This is the night.
When Christ broke the prison bars of death and rose victorious from the underworld, our birth would have been no gain had we not been redeemed. Oh, wonder of your humble care for us, oh love, oh charity beyond all telling, to ransom a slave, you gave away your son, oh truly necessary sin of Adam, destroyed completely by the death of Christ. Oh, happy fault that earned so great, so glorious a Redeemer. Oh, truly blessed night, looks the
Dear brothers and sisters, now that we have begun our solemn vigil, let us listen with quiet hearts to the word of God. Let us meditate on how God in times past saved his people, and in these, the last days, has sent us his Son as our Redeemer. Let us pray that our God may complete this paschal work of salvation by the fullness of redemption.
A reading from the book of Genesis. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless wasteland, and darkness covered the abyss, while a mighty wind swept over the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. God saw how good the light was. God then separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. Thus evening came, and morning followed, the first day. Then God said, "Let there be a dome in the middle of the waters to separate one body of water from the other." And so it happened. God made the dome, and it separated the water above the dome from the water below it. God called the dome the sky. Evening came and morning followed, the second day. Then God said, "Let the water under the sky be gathered into a single basin so that the dry land may appear." And so it happened. The water under the sky was gathered into its basin, and the dry land appeared. God called the dry land the earth, and the basin of the water he called the sea. God saw how good it was. Then God said, "Let the earth bring forth vegetation, every kind of plant that bears seed, and every kind of fruit tree on earth that bears fruit with its seed in it." And so it happened. The earth brought forth every kind of plant that bears seed, and every kind of fruit tree on earth that bears fruit with its seed in it. God saw how good it was. Evening came and morning followed, the third day. Then God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate day from night. Let them mark the fixed times, the days and the years, and serve as luminaries in the dome of the sky to shed light upon the earth." And so it happened. God made the two great lights, the greater one to govern the day and the lesser one to govern the night. And he made the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to shed light upon the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. God saw how good it was. Evening came and morning followed, the fourth day. Then God said, "Let the water teem with an abundance of living creatures, and on the earth let birds fly beneath the dome of the sky." And so it happened. God created the great sea monsters and all kinds of swimming creatures with which the water teems, and all kinds of winged birds. God saw how good it was, and God blessed them, saying, "Be fertile, multiply, and fill the water of the seas, and let the birds multiply on the earth." Evening came, and morning followed, the fifth day. Then God said, "Let the earth bring forth all kinds of living creatures, cattle, creeping things, and wild animals of all kinds." And so it happened. God made all kinds of wild animals, all kinds of cattle, and all kinds of creeping things of the earth. God saw how good it was. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and the cattle, and over all the wild animals and all the creatures that crawl on the ground." God created man in his image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, saying, "Be fertile and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and all the living things that move on the earth." God also said, "See, I give you every seed-bearing plant all over the earth, and every tree that has seed-bearing fruit on it to be your food, and to all the animals of the land, all the birds of the air, and all the living creatures that crawl on the ground, I give all the green plants for food." And so it happened. God looked at everything he had made, and he found it very good. Evening came and morning followed, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth and all their array were completed. Since on the seventh day God was finished with the work he had been doing, he rested on the seventh day from all the work he had undertaken. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who are wonderful in the ordering of all your works, may those you have redeemed understand that there exists nothing more marvelous than the world's creation in the beginning, except that at the end of the ages, Christ our Passover has been sacrificed, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward, and you lift up your staff, and with hand outstretched over the sea, split the sea in two, that the Israelites may pass through it on dry land. But I will make the Egyptians so obstinate that they will go in after them. Then I will receive glory through Pharaoh and all his army, his chariot and charioteers. The Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I receive glory through Pharaoh and his chariots and charioteers." The angel of God, who had been leading Israel's camp, now moved and went around behind them. The column of cloud also, leaving the front, took up its place behind them, so that it came between the camp of the Egyptians and that of Israel. But the cloud now became dark, and thus the night passed without the rival camps coming any closer together all night long. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord swept the sea with a strong east wind throughout the night, and so it turned into dry land. When the water was thus divided, the Israelites marched into the midst of the sea on dry land, with the water like a wall to their right and to their left. The Egyptians followed in pursuit. All Pharaoh's horses and chariots and charioteers went after them, right into the midst of the sea. In the night watch, just before dawn, the Lord cast through the column of the fiery cloud upon the Egyptian force a glance that threw it into a panic, and so he clogged their chariot wheels so that they could hardly drive. With that, the Egyptians sounded the retreat before Israel, because the Lord was fighting for them against the Egyptians. Then the Lord told Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, that the water may flow back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and their charioteers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea flowed back to its normal depth. The Egyptians were fleeing head-on toward the sea when the Lord hurled them into its midst. As the water flowed back, it covered the chariots and the charioteers of Pharaoh's whole army, which had followed the Israelites into the sea. Not a single one of them escaped. But the Israelites had marched on dry land through the midst of the sea, with the water like a wall to their right and to their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel on that day from the power of the Egyptians. When Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the seashore and beheld the great power that the Lord had shown against the Egyptians, they feared the Lord and believed in him and in his servant Moses. Then Moses and the Israelites sang this song to the Lord. "I will sing to the Lord, for he is gloriously triumphant. Horse and chariot he has cast into the sea." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, whose ancient wonders remain undimmed in the splendor even in our day, for what you once bestowed on a single people, freeing them from Pharaoh's persecution by the power of your right hand, now you bring about as the salvation of the nations through the waters of rebirth. Grant, we pray, that the whole world may become children of Abraham and inherit the dignity of Israel's birthright. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, all you who are thirsty, come to the water. You who have no money, come receive grain and eat. Come without pain and without cost, drink wine and milk. Why spend your money for what is not bread, your wages for what fails to satisfy? Heed me and you shall eat well. You shall delight in rich fare. Come to me heedfully, listen, that you may have life. I will renew with you the everlasting covenant, the benefits assured to David. As I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander of nations, so shall you summon a nation you knew not. And nations that knew you not shall run to you, because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, who has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call him while he is near. Let the scoundrel forsake his way, and the wicked man his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord for mercy, to our God who is generous in forgiving. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my ways above your ways, and my thoughts above your thoughts. For just as from the heavens the rain and snow come down, and do not return there till they have watered the earth, making it fertile and fruitful, giving seed to the one who sows, and bread to the one who eats, so shall my word be that it goes forth from my mouth. My word shall not return to me void, but shall do my will, achieving the end for which I sent it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Surely it has come.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, sole hope of the world, who by the preaching of your prophets unveiled the mysteries of this present age, graciously increase the longing of your people, for only at the prompting of your grace do the faithful progress in any kind of virtue. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And now, my friends, we sing out in a joyous song as we turn to the Lord and sing out our glory to God. Sacred night radiant with the glory of the Lord's resurrection, stir up in your church a spirit of adoption, so that renewed in body and mind, we may render you undivided service through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, are you unaware that we who were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him through baptism into death, so that, just as Christ raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness of life. For if we have grown into union with him through a death like his, we shall also be united with him in the resurrection. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that our sinful body might be done away with, that we might no longer be in slavery to sin. For a dead person has been absolved from sin. If, then, we had died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. As to his death, he died to sin once and for all. And as to his life, he lives for God. Consequently, you too must think of yourselves as being dead to sin and living for God in Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven, approached, rolled back the stone, and sat upon it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing was as white as snow. The guards were shaken with fear of him and became like dead men. Then the angel said to the women in reply, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are seeking Jesus, the crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." Then they went away quickly from the tomb, fearful yet overjoyed, and ran to announce this to the disciples. And behold, Jesus met them on their way and greeted them. They approached, embraced his feet, and did him homage. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." In song, let us acclaim the gospel of the Lord.
friends, just first of all, a blessed Easter to each of you and to your families and to your loved ones. This is our season as redeemed Christians. This really is the most marvelous night of all, the night on which all of human history was transformed. And so I pray these days, as we are continuing to be secluded, can be days of rejoicing, of opening the windows and being glad that Christ has broken through our walls, that he has conquered the tomb. Tonight we indeed celebrate Jesus Christ, who confronts and conquers death, who gives us liberation. As Lent began, we saw Christ go into the desert to declare to Satan and to sin and to death that your reign of fear and terror over my people is coming to an end. And tonight we mark those milestone moments in God breaking into history and saving his people. Moments that all point to this night. So we bring new light to old problems, my friends, new sight to old blindness, new life to a world fractured and worn out by this current pandemic. And as Jesus has been at the center of all that we've done, from Thursday's Last Supper to Friday's agonizing way of the cross, so tonight, Christ is at the center. And as we hear from the gospel account, we would expect Christ to be present in all his glory and on full display. And yet when we come to the gospel, he's not there at all. It's a strange thing to think about. It's almost like making the game-winning shot and running straight into the locker room, or winning some national award and walking out of the auditorium, or planning your whole wedding and then not showing up. Where is the resurrected Jesus? It's not like we'd expect. In fact, if I had a say in how the resurrection would have unfolded, I might have thought of Jesus going to Pilate's palace or to Herod's home and saying something like, "How do you like me now?" But that's just probably because I've been doing a lot of video production lately, spending a lot of time editing videos and uploading things to YouTube. I would turn Jesus into Hollywood Jesus, most likely, and not the Lord of the resurrection we encounter this night. Instead, what we have here are these women who come. And they come to the tomb, not because they believe Jesus is going to rise from the dead. No, they come to anoint him. They come because they love him. And that's why you're here tonight as well. Whether it's because of your deep faith or a simple curiosity about who this Jesus Christ is, it's love that's brought all of us here tonight. Perhaps like you, I've been surrounded most of my life by women like this. Two grandmothers, 16 aunts, a mom, two sisters, others who have prayed for me, like the Poor Clare sisters, like the seven sisters in our parishes, and so many others who have poured out their lives in witness to the love of Jesus Christ. They take up sometimes very menial tasks, but they do it with such profound love, drawing from the wellsprings of their own hearts, and go to love Jesus Christ. Women who have loved Jesus in a unique way and have communicated as only they can. The great announcement of this night, my friends, is that the resurrection has an impact on our lives. It's not something from the past, but something alive and active and real in our very midst. Perhaps we can touch the pulse of what these women experienced when they went to this tomb. We're told they leave early and are anxious about the things that they can't control. They couldn't save their beloved Jesus from death. When they got there, they worried about the tomb and about the stone. We too can be anxious about so many things we can't control. This current pandemic is just the last example. There will be others in the future, my friends, of things that we were completely without control of. How do we respond to those moments? What's our first impulse? Where does fear bring us? It's good for us to ask those questions. Next, these women, they come to an empty tomb. And this is a sign that their greatest hopes are dashed. The body they had hoped to anoint, now they fear has been stolen away. We too have had great hopes in our lives. We've mapped out our 5-year plan, our 10-year plan, and especially in these last few weeks, perhaps some of our future plans have been wiped away. Some of our future security has been wiped away. What do we do when those things we had placed our hope in are now seemingly not there? Who do we turn to? What do we turn to? Next, we find an angel announcing good news. These familiar words, "Do not be afraid," we hear so often. So easy to say, "Do not be afraid." Have we ever shared those words with another? A child cowering in fear from a storm, a grown child who's had their job or their hopes dashed, an aging parent who is afraid to face the last days of their life. Do not be afraid, we say. And yet do we say it from a place of trust? Because we are not the manufacturers of this trust, my friends. But to say those words means we draw from a deeper source. Do not be afraid, the angel tells these women. It's a challenge for us. It's a challenge for us not to be afraid. And yet, if we think about where our faith has come from, we think of those towering figures in our life who were the foundations of our faith. When they would say, "Do not be afraid," we believed them. We trusted them. I think about those, perhaps this year, whom you will share faith with. The powerful witness of your life of resurrection is going to touch others' lives, my friends. Will we have the prompting of the Holy Spirit to articulate to them when they ask about the reason for the hope that is in us? I hope we do, like these women. For they hear this good news and they begin running back to the disciples. And along the way, in the midst of their activity, what takes place? Jesus enters in unexpectedly. His first words to them, "Do not be afraid." Again, he speaks those things directly to their hearts and then tells them that he will meet the disciples where? Back in Galilee. Why back in Galilee? It's because this is where this love story began. It's where Jesus Christ first chose his disciples, first chose those he would call to preach his good news from the beginning. My friends, on this Easter Vigil night, it's good for us to go back to the beginnings, where your faith began, where you first fell in love, where you first heard the name Jesus, or perhaps first celebrated this Easter Vigil in a meaningful way. Let us draw upon our own memories of Christ entering our lives. These days, my friends, are centered on Jesus Christ. He does it, though, for you and for me. Let the resurrected heart that lies in your own body would be something that would say, Alleluia, he is risen. Do not be afraid. My friends, we now turn now and we sing out as we raise our voices and call upon our friends, the saints. Sacramental signs, and who in many ways have prepared water, your creature, to show forth the grace of baptism. O God, whose Spirit in the first moments of the world's creation hovered over the waters, so that the very substance of water would even then take to itself the power to sanctify. O God, who by the outpouring of the flood foreshadowed regeneration, so that from the mystery of the one and same element of water would come an end to vice and a beginning to virtue. O God, who caused the children of Abraham to pass dry shod through the Red Sea, so that the chosen people set free from slavery to Pharaoh would prefigure the people of the baptized. O God, whose Son, baptized by John in the waters of the Jordan, was anointed with the Holy Spirit, and as he hung upon the cross, gave forth water from his side along with blood, and after his resurrection commanded his disciples, go forth, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Look now, we pray, upon the face of your church, and graciously unseal for her the fountain of baptism. May this water receive by the Holy Spirit the grace of your only begotten Son, so that human nature, created in your image and washed clean through the sacrament of baptism from all the squalor of the life of old, may be found worthy to rise to the life of the newborn child through water and the Holy Spirit. May the power of the Holy Spirit, O Lord, we pray, come down through your Son into the fullness of this font, so that all who have been buried with Christ by baptism into death may rise again to life with him who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Dear brothers and sisters, through the Paschal Mystery we have been buried with Christ in baptism, so that we may walk with him in newness of life. And so now that our Lenten observance is concluded, let us renew the promises of holy baptism, by which we renounce Satan and his works, and promise to serve God in the Holy Catholic Church. And so I ask all of you, do you renounce Satan?
I do.
And all his works?
I do.
And all his empty show?
I do.
Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth?
I do.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father?
I do.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting?
I do.
May Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and bestowed on us forgiveness of our sins, keep us by his grace, in Christ Jesus our Lord, for eternal life.
Amen. Amen.
Let us raise up now these prayers of petition.
That the Holy Church will ever proclaim the light of Christ as the true Savior of the world, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That people of all nations will strive to live as Jesus Christ, filled with salvation and hope of new life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who have been baptized or received into the church tonight will be freed from all sin and live in the light of Christ raised from the dead. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all those whose lives are shadowed by poverty or anxiety may find true peace, light, and hope. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those living with the fear of disease will find a sense of calm and and shelter in Christ, we especially pray for people who are suffering from the coronavirus. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, they may rise raised to new life with Christ Jesus. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, you are almighty and all-powerful. Tonight we see revealed your plan of salvation in Jesus Christ, your Son. Let us receive this salvation with joy, and may you hear these prayers, for we ask them all through Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all of his holy church.
Accept, we ask, O Lord, the prayers of your people with the sacrificial offerings, that what has begun in the Paschal mysteries may, by the working of your power, bring us to the healing of eternity. Through Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord, our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but on this night above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death, and by rising, restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Augustine and Saint Monica, and all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, Donald, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Amen. At the Savior Peter's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be saved. In a spiritual communion, so please now pray with us.
My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and as I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come into my heart spiritually. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Come to me and be.
Let us pray. Pour out on us, O Lord, the spirit of your love, and in your kindness make those you have nourished by this Paschal sacrament one in mind and heart, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Friends, again, just a blessed Easter, a blessed resurrection to you and your loved ones. Let us live from this new source, this fresh source of grace. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia. Alleluia.